The case for Islam is being hacked to pieces before our eyes. For nearly 14 centuries, Muslim leaders have been able to keep their people insulated, protected from hearing criticisms against Islam and from hearing serious presentations of alternatives to Islam. That ship has sailed, largely due to the internet. A Muslim sheikh in a city in Saudi Arabia is no longer in a position to keep his congregation in a state of ignorance because the people in his congregation have laptops and internet connections. The result is that Islamic arguments that could only spread in an atmosphere of ignorance are now being exposed. But what I find most amusing in all of this is that as the myths are being shattered, Muslim scholars and apologists and Dawagandists are thumping their chests and claiming that everything is fine and that they've refuted everyone. It reminds me of a scene from Monty Python and the Holy Grail when King Arthur meets a knight who's guarding a bridge.
You have proved yourself worthy. Will you join me? You make me sad. So be it. Come, Patsy.
None shall pass.
What?
None shall pass.
But I must cross this bridge.
Then you shall die.
Pretty intimidating. But we're on a quest for the Holy Quran and the holy narrative here. So we must cross that bridge.
I command you, as King of the Britons, to stand aside.
I move for no man.
So an argument breaks out. The Dawa Knight tells us that the Quran has been perfectly and miraculously preserved right down to the letter. There's only one Quran. There isn't a single difference anywhere in any Quran manuscript in the entire world. This proves that the Quran is the inspired word of Allah. Then we do a little research and we find that, according to Muslim sources, entire chapters of the Quran were lost because Muhammad's companions were too lazy to recite them. Large passages were lost because the only Muslims who had them memorized died in battle. Verses were eaten by a sheep. Uthman had to burn countless manuscripts in order to cover up the differences in early Qurans. And even today, there are different Qurans in different parts of the world. So that argument has been hacked off. And yet Muslim scholars and apologists and Dawagandists are pretending that everything is just fine.
Now stand aside, worthy adversary.
'Tis but a scratch.
A scratch? Your arm's off.
No, it isn't.
But what's that then?
I've heard worse.
So the fight continues. The delusional Dawa Knight insists that the Quran contains miraculous scientific insights that couldn't have been known at the time of Muhammad. Then we do a little research, and we find that, according to the Quran, the sun sets in a muddy pool. Semen is formed between the backbone and the ribs. The earth is flat. There are seven earths. The sun orbits the earth. Human embryos are blood clots. The sky is a solid object that would fall on us if Allah didn't hold it up. And stars are missiles that Allah uses to shoot demons who try to sneak into heaven.
Victory is mine!
But is that going to stop the Dawa? Of course not. Everything is just fine in Dawaville. Nothing to worry about.
We thank thee, Lord, that in thy mercy... Ah! Oh!
Come on, then.
What? Have at you! You are indeed brave tonight, but the fight is mine.
Oh, had enough, eh?
So the Dawa Knight blasts us with Muhammad's amazing moral perfection. Muhammad never had a drop of alcohol in his entire life. He only chopped down trees when it was really important to do so. Well, just go ahead and insert any good thing a person can do and pretend Muhammad did it. He's so wonderful, he must have been a prophet. Then we do a little research, and we find that Muhammad had sex with a prepubescent girl. He took the wife of his own adopted son after causing the divorce by lusting after her. He bought, owned, sold, and traded black African slaves. He had sex with his slave girls. He tortured a man for money. He robbed caravans. He allowed his followers to beat their wives into submission and to rape their female captives and to hire prostitutes. In other words, Muhammad had all of the features of a profoundly immoral man.
Right!
But everything is still fine with the Dawah. This is no time to panic. It's always sunny on planet Dawah.
Right, I'll do you for that.
You what?
Come here. What are you gonna do, bleed on me?
That's when the Dawah Knight pulls his trump card. Islam is the world's fastest growing religion, so it must be true. Islam is invincible.
I'm invincible!
Then we do a little research, and we find that the rapid growth of Islam has almost nothing to do with conversions. The rapid growth of Islam is primarily the result of high Muslim birth rates. Why do Muslims have higher birth rates than other groups? It's because of the impact Islam has on women. In many parts of the Muslim world, educating girls is frowned upon. Women having careers is frowned upon. Girls are married off at a young age and turned into baby-making machines. And if a man can have four of these baby-making machines, he can have way, way more kids than his non-Muslim counterparts. So his religion grows because he has more babies than other men. Is this good evidence for Islam?
Come on, then!
The arms and legs of the Dawah Knight have been chopped off. But if we watch videos by Muslim scholars like Sheikh Yasser Qadhi or Muslim apologists like Zakir Naik, the Dawah is moving forward. It's non-Muslims who are afraid. It's non-Muslims who are panicking.
Running away, eh? Come back here and take what's coming to you! I'll bite your legs off!
Isn't it great to be part of the generation that gets to watch Islam implode like this? Muslim scholars and apologists and Dawahgandists are making videos, then deleting the videos because of the backlash. They're babbling about golden showers and threatening people's wives. They're doxing critics of Islam, trying to get them killed. They're threatening to execute ex-Muslims and even bragging about it. They're heaping abuse on anyone who dares speak a word against Muhammad and the Quran. They're doing everything they can to appear strong outwardly. But inwardly, they know that their case is collapsing and that there's absolutely nothing they can do to stop it. Their chest thumping and rants are attempts to put band-aids on the spots where their arguments used to be before they were chopped off. I'd offer them a hug, but they're too mad at me to accept one. A few months or years from now, however, when they're ex-Muslims, they'll be thanking us for exposing their fake prophet and his stupid, stupid book. Until then, cheers and jihadi tears.